still need six of you, but we'll have to do that. Okay, so let's get on to the first bit. Preamble pop quiz. Obviously, I'm going to be thinking of people, so I hope some of you have done some of this. So, what's the significance of Tom's Diner in your everyday life? Who wants to tell me anything about that? Yes? MP3 format, good. Anybody want to elaborate on that bit more? MP3 format? You guys are done.
The guy who was coming up with the encoding of MP3 just heard it, and because there were so many random little inflections in her voice and the acapella version, it was really like a gold standard of knowing that the MP3 format works.
Right. Okay. So that's exactly right. Okay. So that's why it's important for your everyday life. It's important for the user experience because obviously your experience of MP3, listening to MP3, would be much detracted if this wasn't used. Okay. Actually, it's known as the mother of MP3. Okay. What properties of Tom's Diner have made it so significant? Well, you've answered that. It's the little inflections, the acapella version. And when the inventor of MP3 heard this in the corridor, what did he think? Anybody got any idea? Why is this good science?
Because he was willing to consider edge cases, maybe?
Yes, because he was willing to consider edge cases, but also because this thing here, he was walking through the corridor and he thought, wow, I'm never going to be able to, MP3 is never going to work with this. With this song, MP3 is going to crash. That's what he thought. He was expecting it to crash. He wasn't thinking, oh, here's another great song that I can just say works with MP3. He was expecting it to crash, okay? But MP3 would not encode this. And if that's the case, then that's good science because he's trying to prove himself wrong. Okay? And it turns out that it did do a really good job on this, and that means that we can be more, that his idea of MP3 was more solidly supported. Okay? That's the reason. So, that's why it's significant for us, that's why it's significant to the user experience, that's why it's a good representation of what good science is. He didn't try and think, let's have more songs that I can say are great with MP3, which is often how it works in business. What he said was, what will break MP3? What's the most difficult thing I can do that will break it? And by it working, he supported his hypothesis that MP3 would be okay. Yeah. So, that being the case, who actually did any of this? Who actually went and did anything with Tom's Diner or heard it or saw it? Listen to it, yes, for you people, okay, good. I'm trying to give you some cultural experience here, but you're just not going to take it, you know, what can you do? Okay. The other thing is, just something you ought to know, you guys sitting down at the front, this is my visual dead area, okay, 1 to 2 metres, there's an actual term for it, okay, so this means that I might not see you making face calls, so you need to be more kind of, okay? Okay. So, I presume you've all now submitted this glorious blackboardy stuff. Yeah? Through turning in and locking, yes. Okay, so we're going to talk about this in more detail in a little while. Well, in this first lecture. Okay? And then in the second lecture we're going to go and look a bit more into what a human being is. Okay? And what should matter to you. So on this point, let's just have, I just want to sort of get some ideas about what you thought about it, not from your discussion, not from your 250-word abstracts, but in general. Are we any closer, after reading this, to knowing what you think user experience is? So I'm going to start picking out random people, because you've all done it, if you don't, you're going to get some takers. Yes?
I think that it raised a load of points in the whole paper. I didn't really find myself disagreeing with any of it.
Yeah.
But because it's so vague, there are so many different interpretations, I would have been happy with them all or a combination of it all if I was to define it, which I wouldn't even dream to try.
Okay, cool. Of the actual paper itself, how did you see that the science worked? Did you like the fact that you've got certain confidence in the mean scores and that kind of thing, and what people thought, the number of participants?
I like the Finland-US divide. Yeah. Well, that was really funny.
On the other hand, wasn't that possibly because most of the US was in industry as opposed to being research?
Yeah.
So I would like to clear statistics.
Yeah. That's good. Very good. Okay, any more thoughts on it? So, just by reading this paper, you can think to yourself, you could just take this paper and say, oh yes, absolutely yes, I agree that the paper says so and the science says so, but you picked up some good stuff that there's a divide that, I mean, they say that in the paper, but people are often likely to ignore that divide because they don't want a complicated argument. And so therefore it's not, it doesn't give you everything that you're expecting to get. Okay? So this finished divide, why is it happening? Why is there a divide between this? There's only, what, three, four countries really well represented when there's 69% of the population living in the Far East, and this is not the Far East stuff. Yeah. Okay. Any more thoughts on the paper itself? Any more thoughts on the user experience? What do you think might kind of... Okay, well, what do you think might define the user experience, for instance, in the way that we think about groups of people or individuals? Transitory experiences or non-transitory experiences? So right there is the top thing.
You get influenced by your peers, by the social groups you're in. And some actually thought you can even describe your experience like that, but then they disagree, saying that actually it's your own experience, it's just the context that might influence you, but in the end it's up to you. And your past, maybe your earlier experience and later ones that actually determine your experience.
Yeah, that's very true, yeah. I mean, also there's a point whereby we will be seeing this in a little while, that normally in HCI, we're interested in like this kind of generalised, what can be generalised. So, is an individual experience valid? Is a transitory individual experience valid? And if you look at the tables here, in this paper, it seems that most people believe that a transitory experience for one person is still valid. Okay, it's something that helps us define what the actual user experience is, not what the group user experience is, if you like. Okay, any other... Yes?
Well, will that not result into design by committee, in a way? You're trying to please a group of people, but the perception of beauty, according to that, to those groups can change. Let's say our perception of fashion has changed in 50 years, 60 years. So is that a very good kind of measure for UX?
Well, it just depends, because it depends what you're trying to measure. So you say you're trying to please everybody. Maybe you're not trying to please everybody, but you're trying to know why you're not pleasing everybody. You might want to know what are the kind of problems, or what are the things that some people don't like that others do. Maybe you're trying to make your system flexible so that people can personalise it at certain points. So if you know that they're interested that, certain aspects of the user experience are for a particular piece of software are split.
That's just then, behavioural design.
Yeah. So therefore you can try and personalise or create some adaptive engine that allows people to change that so that they're happy with it in the context, how they want it to be. But the rest of the machinery is still okay. It's still you don't have to bother with. Okay. Any more? Yes.
I found the statements interesting that all of the statements that had like group agreement, they when you read them one sentence they created like a conflict. So for instance they say that they agree that you should measure user experience during the time during the experiment.
Yeah.
And another statement says that the user experience are changing throughout the experiment, so it becomes like highly subjective just like when you measure it.
Yeah. Yes, that's true. It becomes highly subjective when you measure it too. And that's just something that we have to account for with users, because users just aren't, they don't have the same emotional response to things all the time. Okay, it's their ups and downs. They've been out late the night before and they're tired or whatever. There's no real way of understanding exactly what's going on. You can understand what kind of is generalizable by what lots of people are thinking. And that's one of the things we're going to look at as well. So it's a combination of things that you need to be focused on or think about. So there's not just one specific answer. So when you get into a company and that you're told there's one specific answer, then that's not quite the case, and that's what I want you to understand, that you need to be curious, you need to make sure that you're critical of what people are telling you, because there isn't just one particular answer to all of this. Okay. So, let's just look a bit more about where human-computer interaction came from. So we've got first of all the HCR, UX emergence. So, anybody want to, you've all read your notes, I'm sure. So who wants to tell me anything about human-computer interaction? Does anybody know anything about it? What's the main characteristic that defines most, or has defined most, HCR work? Any idea? No? Okay, well, I said this last week, it's quantitative work, it's measured stuff. So a lot of HCR work has become about measuring things, about measuring time, task time, about measuring time to first fixation, about measuring gaze duration, about measuring galvanic skin response, about measuring something. If you've got numbers that you can measure, then it means that you're in a lot better position to support your arguments. And they're far easier to process. So you'll have lots of questionnaires. There'll be a questionnaire for this course, for instance. And that questionnaire will have little boxes 1 through 5, tick which you like, choose the number. Okay? Well, if it's done right, and I won't be doing it, if it's done right, it'll be a Likert scale, it's called, if you want 1 through 5, which will try and quantify how you like it. But the questions are already biased because the university's chosen the questions to ask. Okay? They haven't said to you, which is called qualitative work, they haven't said to you, tell me what you thought of this course randomly. Just tell me what anything about it. Why is that? Why do they use numbers and not, yes?
Because it could very well put them in a very bad light.
Well, that's one reason, but I think that's quite a...
Qualitative is a lot harder to measure and put in statistical...
That's right.
...statistical analysis.
Yeah, it takes far more time for a person to go through textual information to find out what the commonalities are. Yes?
Yeah. No, the other thing I was going to say was, if you have open-answered questions, it leaves whoever's reading the text to their interpretation of how they can measure a response to a question, to an open-ended question. So if they're reading response, they can. It's up to them to measure and get a quantitative representation of that open-ended question. So
yeah.
It's maybe less accurate as well.
Yeah, that can be true. So you can sacrifice something which is very easily quantifiable from things that are kind of rich, understanding rich information. Now, it's not quite right, because we're going to see that there's techniques called bizarre coding in anthropology, which we use for ethnographies, whereby we can go through looking for concepts in textual information, classify those concepts, and then keep classifying other participants into those concepts, so that we can see if one of you mentioned too many lecture notes, then we could see that, you know, how many people mentioned too many lecture notes in their discursive information. Okay, so that's something we can look for, and we'll be getting onto that later on. But that is very true. It takes lots longer. So it's a lot easier to just process numbers. But those numbers don't tell you everything. Okay? And HCI originally was a lot about that. There's a change now called user-centered design, which we'll also be looking at in this course. Which allows us to kind of be a bit more qualitative about things, okay? But originally, HCR was all about quantity. And what else did that quantity allow us to do? What kind of inferences did it allow us to make? Yes?
You can compare different user experiences or different user experiences from different products.
Right, you can compare different user experiences from different products, different user experiences, because it allows us to generalise. So it's generalisable. We can say, well, if the proper sample, you guys, of the third year, the population of the third year, you're the sample, if you say something, then we can probably see numerically that we can generalise that to everybody in the third year. Okay, that's what we normally do. It's a lot harder to do with qualitative information, okay, because it's far more about individual kind of ideas and subjectivity. Okay. And so what was initially required was in HCR was some way, and in social science and sociology and psychology in a lot of ways, some way of saying that the information that was coming back was generalizable, it was scientific, it was more like physics, say, or chemistry, or something like this, where you've got absolutes. And so the way to get closer to absolutes was to have numbers into new statistics. Now, we then see that there's a number of disparate fields that started to coalesce into this HCI kind of idea. So psychology, sociology, social science, and computer science all started to coalesce. There's also a bit of anthropology, but mainly it's these three. Okay. These three fields, psychology, sociology, and computer science. So these were three disparate fields that started to coalesce into understanding people and computers. So psychology, people's thoughts, sociology, groups, people, and computer science, the actual products, the actual kind of computer artifacts themselves. And so these are disparate fields that started to come together. But in HCI, computer science mainly took psychology and sociology research methods, okay, things that were about measuring in tightly controlled laboratory-based experiments, certainly for psychology, controlling for certain factors which weren't real-world factors or which would be experienced in the real world, but might screw up your results because you want a numeric, generalizable result, so you have to control a lot for variables. So this control for variables lets us remove what kind of variable. Who's done a bit of HCI or sociology or that kind of stuff, psychology, before?
Is it confounding?
Confounding variables, okay? So there's a thing called confounding variables which we're trying to control for in psychological laboratory-based experiments. Okay. Sociology is really where the questionnaire comes in. So what sociology is trying to do is to aggregate large numbers of people. And the way to do it, really, most of the time, is to use questionnaire-based techniques. Okay? So when you get a survey that comes around, or you get stopped in the street, okay, for a survey about something or other, that's more a sociological survey, not a psychological one, because it's not about what you, your brain itself, what it's thinking, what you're doing, the cognition, perception, behaviour. It's more about how you think about other things in society. Okay? So with sociology, and with these kind of, if you like, when you get stopped in the street, market survey, that kind of thing, what kind of, you form part of a sample. So when you see things like political polls, a poll that somebody puts on this political poll, and they say, we've got 1,000 people. Okay, so 1,000 people's been seen to be a reasonable size sample for this kind of work. What kind of sample is it called? Do you know what the kind of sample is that if you were just stopped in the street to ask a question, what kind of sample is that? It's called a convenience sample because it's convenient. Okay, so if I came up and said to you, do my survey, and then I said, point me to somebody else, and you pointed me to a friend here, then that would be called snowball sampling. So there's lots of different sampling techniques, which we'll get onto, that were used. And these kind of sampling techniques allow you to say things or to make very firm or not firm statements about the kind of data that you're getting back. So for instance, a truly random sample has far more confidence attached to it than a snowball sample, because you two are likely to think the same thing because you're friends. Yeah? It's got far more validity in science than, say, a convenience sample. Why might that be? Say you're on the street and you're asking for political stuff, okay, you first, then you get.
You're in a rush, so you probably just say whatever and get it over done with, which might be something else.
Okay, so you're in a rush and you want to just get it over with, yeah?
Well, it depends where you are on the street, what street you actually are on, and what time of day it is.
Yes.
Obviously, you're not going to get during like midweek hours, people are normally working, you're going to get a different sort of survey.
That's
so
true.
Going at a different time.
Yeah, very true. Yeah.
What effect is that? Does program might influence what kind of people you're encountering, maybe the neighborhood?
Okay.
There might be like people with certain political views living in a certain neighborhood.
Okay, cool.
You would probably take someone that they would give you the time of day, such an old person, or someone that would actually respond to it.
Respond to it, say, yeah.
The type of survey, so what they'd like to look at you, so you answer the questions.
Yes, and in fact, that's one of the major points, bizarrely, and sadly, just goes back to our basic influence, doesn't it? That we can see that in convenience sampling, if you're a male experimenter, and you're left to do what you like, the vast majority of your participants, your samples, are female, 25-ish. Yeah? And if you're a female experimenter, the most likely sample is 40-year-old males. Also, you're far less likely to be asked any survey questions if you have a dog, because people don't want to get near the dog because they think, oh, dog, it's going to bite me. Or, especially if you have people coming around to your house asking questions, they're far more likely to ask questions from people who don't have dogs barking, because they're scared they're going to get bitten, than anywhere else. They're far more likely, if you live on the top floor of a block of flats, apartment block, nobody's coming to your house. Okay, they're all going to stay on the bottom, okay? Unless there's some control put in place. So what I'm trying to get here is that all surveys aren't the same, okay? They're not. It depends on who, why, what's the motivation of the survey, who's selected, who isn't. So when somebody comes to you in a company and says, oh, this is the right answer, you need to be more questioning about it, because how did they collect it? What was the sample? How big was the sample? Who was in the sample? Did it represent true demographics of your target population, for instance? All these questions need to be answered. Okay? Okay. So, user experience and HCI then start to evolve into these three things: creation, application, and testing. Okay? So what we do is we build something, we apply it, and then we test it. Okay? We often didn't do anything here at the start. We don't ask people anything. We just decide we're going to build it. Most coders and most apps say, oh, I've got a good idea. Right, bang it out. Okay, and then stick it out there. And hopefully somebody will buy it or not. They're not really asking what people want, and they're not really testing or asking whether they've done it right at the end after they deployed it. Okay. Now, in lots of cases, this doesn't matter. If you're creating maybe an app that you just want to make some money from and you think it's a good idea, it might be okay and it might not. Who'd have thought Twitter would be in any way successful? I mean, it's just crazy madness, 140 characters. But it's successful. Okay, so who knows? So you've got to take that with a little bit of a pinch of salt as well. There's a certain new kind of design called autobiographical design. Okay, so you can Google that. And autobiographical design, there's a nice article in the Interactions magazine about it, it's in Interactions. Autobiographical design is just a way of saying, well, you, as coders, probably understand you and your audience quite well to start with, so don't want to ask anybody, just get on with it. Okay? It's probably not a good plan, I don't think. But it depends what your target audience is. If you represent if you think your part dead centre of your target audience, because what you're creating is something that your target audience really wants, and you're part of that target audience, maybe you're the best person to think about that to start with. But if you're not, if you're trying to create something for somebody out of your population, out of your demographics, if you like, then you might need to ask other people. Okay. So, I think user experience is more about practical HCI, so it's human-computer interaction applied into software engineering, into the software engineering process, with benefits. So I think the with benefits part is really about the focus, or at least the fact that we don't not focus on the qualitative aspects and the aspects that intangible stuff and about the individual. Okay? So those things are really important that you often missed. Okay,
So, the importance of UX. Users are not silent. What does this mean?
Based on feedback.
Based on feedback, okay. Who's done requirement solicitation analysis in software engineering? Okay, so who wants to tell me anything about requirement solicitation analysis in software engineering from this big group of people, all chicken, all down at the front?
Usually the users don't even know what they want until they've seen the actual product being built and used themselves.
Okay, so usually the user doesn't know what they want, so that's one thing. Is that really always the case though, in real life? Do you think the users, say if you're building a bespoke system for a company, the users, the people who do use this paper system every day don't really know what they want?
I think they think they know what they want.
Yeah.
Until they've actually seen it and used it and realised there may be better alternatives out there.
Right. Yeah, so that's one thing. So therefore, prototyping, that's a good point of prototyping, so that they can play with something, realise it's screwed up, and then start to move it and then do it again. You're also right that some users don't know what they want. So for instance, there's a very famous quote about Ford. Henry Ford, and he, when asked, you know, the famous thing is, if you asked a load of people, or if he asked a load of people what they wanted at his time, what would their answer be? Faster horse and cart, because they had a concept of car. Okay? So here, with the MP3 stuff, if nobody had the concept of digital audio that they could listen to on a digital system, what would it be that you wanted to make audio better? Clearer audio, you wouldn't want, sound good, MP3. So you have to realise that you might know a lot more than the software engineers. Software engineers might know a lot more about the domain, but you can give people options that they don't understand. So the best place to give them these options might be in, say, focus groups, where you're not just asking questions, but you can kind of guide where the focus group is looking. Yeah? Or you can pose some questions which are biased questions. Okay. Okay, this is really important. However you do it, the system needs to come forward to the user. If anything, I think this is the key thing to take away. Now, how we do it is incredibly difficult. It's incredibly interesting, but it's incredibly difficult. So, systems conform to the user, not vice versa. So at the moment, we're trying to create here systems that conform to lots of different kinds of users. Blind users, mainly sighted users, sometimes. We're trying to see, we strap galvanic skin response machines to people to find out their stress and see whether we can adapt the pages based on how stressful they're feeling about those pages. Okay, so we can adapt that kind of thing. We can pull apart applications called transcoding, put them back together again based on stress, hopefully. But it's really difficult. Well, this is really key. So for you, you need to think, are you expecting users to do lots and lots of, do they have to understand lots that's technical, that they shouldn't need to understand? Do they have to conform to your vision as a software engineer building this stuff, or do you conform to their vision of what they want when they're telling you what they want? Now, of course, you've got the professional aspects, you'll be professionals, okay? So you can guide some of their wants and some of their needs too. But you still need to be mindful that you're not overruling what they said, even if you don't think it's right. The other thing to consider on these things is that people's perception of something matters before they even use it. Okay? So, if somebody perceives that they're going to have a good experience with a system and an application, yet it's a terrible application, they will still feel positive about it after they've used it, even though you might think it would be bad, because they felt positive about it to start with. Okay, so if they're included in the design process, they're far more likely to feel positive about it. If they feel not positive about it, the system can be great, but the outcomes will still be that they don't feel positive about it, even though the system is brilliant. Okay, so it's perception, it's intangible. So you need to be thinking of all this. So the other thing which we've just been discussing is that systems are less concerned with generalizability. We're more concerned with adaptability, with understanding individual needs and concerns. And we're less concerned with measuring things quantifiably. We're far less concerned with quantifiable things, and we're also far less concerned with things that are tangible. We're interested in intangible stuff. Is it interesting?
Yeah.
Down there, what is it? No taking or texting for tonight's beer.
Excuse me. Can you give an example of that, the one before the list? This one.
Measurable. Okay, so things that are measurable. So things that you might be able to measure might be task completion time for a particular task. You've set a task. So we have this idea in the HCI of user models. So you can have a top-down view of a user, what the kind of user are, what that user is, and how they should go through your application. Because you know all the buttons, you know where all the screens are, you know how you've set up the interface, you know what behavior you're expecting. So you can measure people through it, okay? So what we're saying is that there's another view, which is called emergence. So instead of you knowing all this stuff, you've built your system as you think is right. But you don't then measure people based on what you know, you let people use it and see what emerges. Okay? So in that way you can understand better how people are doing things. And maybe they're taking the completely wrong route. When you've asked them to do a certain task, they might do that task completely differently to what you've expected, because it's an emergent behaviour that they're not seeing. So it's not measurable directly because you haven't decided to, you don't know what that is yet. Okay, so that's one of those things. And the tangibles and intangibles are very interesting because you can ask people how something looks. Okay, so mainly we were looking at things like intangibles. So you could measure, for instance, aesthetics. Classical aesthetics are quite easy to measure. You can say, oh, is this clear? Is it clean? Is it concise? That's tangible. You can measure that mostly. Okay, and you'll see there's quite a few papers on aesthetics and hierarchies of aesthetics. But intangible, that's different because you have this thing called experiential aesthetics, whereby it's about the individual experience. It's far more difficult to give a numeric answer to that. It's far more difficult. It's intangible. Do you like it? Well, kind of. Don't know. Maybe. Or then the next day, oh yeah, I really like it today. Okay, it's intangible. You don't really know. Okay. So those experiential metrics. Experiential aesthetics are very, it's very difficult to quantify that. Okay, how much more do you like it today than yesterday or this hour than last hour? Okay, all that kind of stuff. So user experience is far less interesting than these things. And the reason why these things are interesting in HCI is because HCI was a new domain, it was nascent, it was emergent. Domain, and so therefore HCI back in the day needed to say, well, we base all our science on something. We are a science, and we base our science on this. And that means measuring stuff, quantifying stuff, and then generalising it, just like we do with all the science. But now we're seeing a step back from that. And so we're including far more things from, say, anthropology, where we're interested in individuals or individual experiences of the world. Okay? Now, I'm a scientist, so some of this user experience stuff, when I think about it, I'm more interested in generalizability a lot of the time because I think there's, you know, you have to generalize to lots of people. But I also realize that I'm not so complacent, that I don't think that the individual experience at particular times is a useful thing to know. Okay, it's also useful to know what we don't know. Yeah, so we don't overreach our claims. Yeah? Okay. More holistic. So the more holistic part is that we're interested in not just tasks, but feelings, emotions. How do we measure emotions? You know, we can use galvanic skin response, we can use heart rate, theoretically, we can use pupil dilation. But all these things which are part of, what kind of nervous system are all those things part of? Autonomic. They're all part of the autonomic nervous system, okay? So those kind of aspects are very, you know, you're not really quite sure why these things are happening. So galvanic skin response, maybe because you're excited or angry. So it might be a good thing in some ways or a bad thing. You see galvanic skin response rise drastically when you're on a roller coaster but you're enjoying it. We also see it rise drastically when you're frustrated in front of a computer screen and you're about to throw it out the window. Okay, so it's difficult to understand, you have to look at the context too. So all those things are kind of intangibles in some way. Okay, So modern user experience is more than this. It's more than just tangible factors. It's more than just functionality. So we're not just talking about understanding. So in requirements analysis, who did, what's the difference between functional and non-functional requirements? Yes?
Non-functional might be something like they want it by a certain date or a performance, say 99% of the time if you're working, but functional would be something they want, like they want to be able to add users or delete users.
Yes. And in the non-functional stuff, you'll get other things like, I want it to look nice, whatever nice might be, or I want it to be easy to use, whatever easy to use is, that kind of thing. Okay, so all this does sit back into the requirements analysis, not for this station. There's a big thing called moments of engagement. Okay, and you'll get a lot of this in design, you'll get a lot of it in marketing design. So moments of engagement mean that you are engaged with a product for a certain period of time and then you're not again. Okay? So there was some nice stuff on Ars Technica this morning, about how lots of times people don't bother using Facebook. They have a break from Facebook for sometimes days, sometimes weeks, sometimes months. Okay? And then they go back to it because they have moments of engagement with it and then they just get bored of it and say, oh, that's enough, there's too much information here on the internet. I've got 16,000 friends who are over there and they're doing that kind of. Yeah? Okay. Touch points. So this is another phrase from design. Okay? So these touch points are things that you always know are going to be there. They're something that make you feel secure about the system. Okay? So there's lots of touch points running through. So the Mac operating system, okay, OS X, lots of touch points about what it looks like, what you can expect. Yeah? Touch point for Mac is also quality. They sell their products on quality. They can charge lots more money because they're selling them to you on quality. Okay, and that's a touch point for them. Yes?
Is a touch point a unique selling point? Like, or
well, it's not quite unique because it can be. But it's not quite unique because first of all, there's lots of sort of a unique selling point. Touch points can be common. So for instance, quality is a common touch point, it's not unique. You know, you could have lots of different stuff. Like the new, for instance, you might decide that the new Windows tablet has a touch point of quality because it's way better than all the other stuff and they're building the hardware. But it's a unique selling point, is a bit more unique, it's a bit more, but it can be a touch point, yeah, because it's the only thing that, say, one particular manufacturer offers. Yeah. Okay, so this is interesting, this is useful from your. Is there any automotive sort of maintenance? Has anybody actually started reading that now? Anybody now? Anybody know? Oh, some people, yeah, good. It's always useful. We'll make you better people. Unification of the scientific and the romantic. Okay, so that's what we're trying to do. It's trying to unite this scientific, functional stuff with the whimsical, maybe even. Okay? With the romantic, with the design, with things that place emphasis on aesthetics. Yeah? To say it's not important is really stupid. Because all this stuff is important. The reason why you're dressed how you are is because you think it conveys something about who you are, about the aesthetics of who you are, etc. Okay? None of you are here in a sackcloth because it's the cheapest thing you can't really get. Yeah? You're here for, you know, in clothes that you've chosen to spend lots of time doing it in shoes and all the other crap, as am I. Well, maybe you don't spend that much time. But that's why it's important. Yeah? Okay. Objectivity blended with subjectivity. What's this mean? It's kind of a bit weird. I like the phrase.
Is it kind of, if you're trying to abstract loads of people's different subjective opinions on something, at some point that kind of becomes a collective, objective thing? Something like that?
Kind of, yes.
Could you say that when someone's trying to be objective, they've always got a motive why they're doing it, so they could have their own subjective bias into what results they get?
Yeah, that's another one.
anymore. So what I'm really trying to get here is that we've got this objectivity, which is all again about, to be objective, you've got to, it's got to be rational, theoretically. It's got to be rational, there's got to be some rational thought behind it. You might maybe have to base it on evidence. You have to base it on certain, even if that evidence is experimental evidence, etc. Okay? Subjectivity, you don't. You can base it on how, what your internal feelings are, and you can feel annoyed for some particular reason. Okay? But you don't know why. It's not, it's subjective, it's not objective. You've got no, you've got nothing to really base it on. There's no rationale there. Yeah? But we, what we're trying to do is blend the two because they're both useful. They're both, both parts of what we are as humans. Yeah? Okay. Measurable and intangible. So we're bringing together things that are measurable and things that, that are intangible at the same time. Things that aren't measurable. And so here, what we're trying to say, what, what's very useful is stuff in your Zen and the Art of Maintenance text, because this talks exactly about these kind of things, where they seem to be against each other. Objectivity is against subjectivity, or measurability and tangibility is against intangibility. But that's not really the case, because we are like that. It's only the case in a kind of educational domain, in an academic domain in some regards. You know, we are all like to a greater or lesser extent. Okay, so differences. So we can hear, so these are the differences. So this is table on page 33 of your notes. Differences among countries of residence. This is obviously from the paper that we were looking at. So who actually spent any time looking at this particular bit? Okay, one, two, yeah. So you first tell, so you guys first tell me what do you think this is all about? What do you think it's telling us?
I think it says a lot about subjectivity in nature, about people in different countries feel differently about what it actually is. And
yeah.
It's definitely demographic based on where you are.
Yeah.
And it's one major thing that comes from it.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. And you can see here that the USA seem to think that, well, their median score for subjectivity is a lot less, which means that they're not so bothered about, they're still thinking maybe it's more about objectivity. Okay? Whereas you see like Finland, they're all, hey, swinging European, real into subjectivity. Yeah? Same is true for, I mean, UK, perhaps a bit strange, but yeah, we seem to think it's subjective as well. Okay. So these are differences that you need to be able to analyse. You'll be given data tables like this when you're doing your standard work in user experience, and you'll need to be able to exactly create that argument. Yeah? Okay. Emotional attachment. So this really suggests that, do we think emotional attachment is really kind of something that's really useful in the user experience? So what do we think based on these numbers, 20 emotional attachment? Yeah.
Well, again, Finland are well into it, or rather more into it than the others, but there's a bit of a, there's a much larger range. Like the biggest standard deviation shows that there are some that think that, you know, this is really important, and then the other side of it, there's another number of people who disagree with it.
Yes.
But overall, on the whole, they're all for it.
Yeah, they're all for it, although when you think the all these mean scores are actually below the mean average, which should be 2.5 because it's out of 5,
yeah.
Right? So they're all a bit kind of shaky on emotional attachment. So why do you think they're a bit shaky on emotional attachment, these guys? Why would it matter? Why do you think that emotional attachment for this group of people maybe not as high as you would maybe want, think it might be? Is it because emotional attachment doesn't matter? That's what they're saying. Or do you think it might be their backgrounds? Are these more industrial people who are not designers or developers? Yes.
Could it also be a gender thing?
Could be a gender thing, yeah.
Obviously. Men aren't as emotional as women, period.
What are you talking about? Yeah, maybe that's true. Yeah, maybe that's very true. So that's true. There's lots of possible reasons for this, and what you need to think of is, just because it says so here, doesn't necessarily
mean to say it's exactly correct. Do you want to actually want to look at what kind of split these people are from? What's their backgrounds? Are they developers? Are they designers? Are they artists? Who are they? But think emotional attachment isn't so useful. If you attach emotionally to something, then it's highly likely that you're going to repeat the purchase, say. The Mac. People are very emotionally attached to their Macs. Okay? They just don't, they just won't let them out of their sight. Now that could be because they're very expensive, or it could be because there's just emotional attachment to it because it can't be designed and I can't. I'd rather be building software where people get an emotional attachment to it because I want to repeat their business if I'm selling to them. Yeah? Okay, and qualitative approach. We can notice here that when we look at qualitative approach, all of these things seem to be more on the kind of qualitative side. Subjectivity, emotional attachment, qualitative approaches. And we can see that through all of these, there's kind of an underlying trend that here, the USA, all seem to be a bit more objective, or seem to want to be. They're all feeling more, not as subjective, it seems to me, not as quality-driven, qualitatively driven. Whereas you get Finland, who seem to be, you know, really up there. Yeah? So I wonder why that might be. That's what you've got to think about too. Now also, what does standard deviation tell you? You've all done some of this, possibly. You've got maths and things, yes?
So for the USA case of 1.2, it tells you that choices were quite spread out. So some people, not everyone went for the mean. There's quite a large range between difference of opinion.
Yeah. It allows you to quantify, it's a measure of what's called central tendency. You heard central tendency? So in statistics, it's a measure of what's called central tendency. How far away from the centre of this stuff people are? What's kind of the error bars, if you like, on the graph? Okay. So we can see here that in Finland, there's a lot more people. People are far more likely to vote for 3.98. than people are likely to vote in the USA for 293, because the USA has a larger standard deviation, which means there's more deviation in the population of the people in the sample that they've taken. Yeah? So some people in the USA might have voted 1.87, because that's just the way that the standard deviation works. Okay? And the same is true for this up here. So the smaller the standard deviation, the far more holistic. The far more together in the centre, the measure of central tendency, the far more together people are in their answers. So if these standard deviations are really huge, then, you know, there's a problem. And we do this in your exam marks, actually. So on this exam, and on all the exams, there's always a measure of standard deviation to see how far away the average spread is. And if it's really big, then we've got a problem. Because it means that some of you are experiencing the exam well, and others just are missing it all. Yeah?
Can we say it gives a kind of a validity to the average?
We don't say that because that means something else in statistics. So it doesn't give that kind of level of, and also in experimental work, so it doesn't give that level, we don't call it validity, but you're right in the concept. Yeah, it lets you think that if the smaller it is, the more unified the voice is. Yeah? The wider it is, the more discordant the voice is. Yeah? Okay. So, this is what I was talking about. At the top, statement. Response rate 95%, N 261, so 261 people responded. The mean is 4.47 with a standard deviation of bugger all. Yeah? 0.04, actually. And we can see that we've got the lower and upper that they've given us. And we can also see fleeting and more stable aspects of a person's internal state, needs and motivations, affect a person's experience of something. Okay, that's the main thing. That's one of the big things that we're looking at from user experience, is these fleeting and more stable aspects. Not just the more stable aspects, as HCI would have expected. Because HCI, we're trying to make stability in laboratory-based trials because we're trying to control for confounding variables, which is the instability, the fleeting stuff. So here we're trying to say that fleeting stuff, this is important. It's all together. Yeah? UX occurs in and is dependent on the context in which the artifact is experienced. So if you experience that artifact in a negative context, you'll think of it negatively. Okay? So it's dependent upon that. You can't just put an artifact that you will, that here, what we're saying is, you can't just put an artifact that you might use in the home into a laboratory situation and expect to get the same results, because the context is important. Context of use is important. Yeah? Prior exposure to an artifact shapes subsequent user experience. So if you've had a bad experience on an artifact, you're likely to have another bad experience on it, because it's likely to shape your view of the experience before you even do it. That's kind of obvious, isn't it? Yeah. My experiences of riding on buses is that I always get sat next to the person who's, you know, smells like a wet dog or is insane. That's my experience. So it shapes the fact that I'd rather come by bike. You know? Okay. Right. So we can see that these 23 statements are sorted by mean agreement. So where would you kind of suggest in here we might want to stop? Where do we think, what things do we want to take on board? What do you think is what things do you want to take on board from this survey? And what things do you want to leave, for instance? Where would you draw the lines?
Yeah. I guess I'd look at the two extremes, the top five, say, and the bottom three, maybe.
Okay, yeah, top five and bottom three. And is there a reason why you've chosen that based on here?
Well,
is there any other means?
It's out of five, so I think less than 2.5 is sort of generally less happy with that statement.
Yeah.
Not. So, look at that.
Okay, so you might choose, I mean, or also you might choose a welfare one, so you might say, well, I'm going to base it on median. So what's the bottom quartile and what's the top quartile, say? Of these, we can see that the standard deviation is pretty similar, so that gives us some confidence that all these are quite nice. We don't have to say anything about these based on the standard deviation, but you can decide to choose, well, I'm going to think about it. I think I'm only going to go for the top 25%. Okay? And that decides where you're going to cut here. It also means that you could also decide, well, actually, I'm going to be more optimistic and go on this lower, the lowest score that each one got. Pessimistic, if you want, no, optimistic. Yeah? The lowest score that each one got, and you cut it there. So, for me, I'm taking all of this down to 3.16. I'm going to take all of that and say, well, all of this stuff here has some validity. It tells us something about what the user experience is. Whereas these things here, well, there's kind of less agreement, so we may be not so bothered about it. They become less important. Yeah? So when I'm teaching this course, I'll be referring to all these bits at the top, based on how frequently I talk to you about it as well. Or at least it's in my mind. Yeah.
Could you not say that perhaps that one at the bottom has in some ways more importance than some of the ones at the top? Because it shows you what people don't want
Yes.
their experience to be like.
Yes, you can. The thing at the bottom is what people maybe don't want. Okay? So, item UX is best for users in marketing. Yeah, it's not. That's what you're saying. It's not. And I choose not to believe that too. In my subjective way. Okay. We're going to just run on a little bit, then we'll get to the break, don't panic. So, of this, these comments, this bit, these two columns at the very end, at the very right-hand side, are the ones that I think are more important. Okay. So, what's the nature of user experience, and what are the key ideas about user experience? Certainly this one here, person, artifact, and environment are all important. Okay? It's triadic, it's three things together. Types of interaction, both conscious and unconscious. That's really important. In HCR, we'd only be looking for conscious interaction. Normally. We wouldn't be necessarily looking for unconscious interaction a lot of the time. Okay. We've also got intangible aspects of UX, complexity of the experience. So these things are all important, so you should go back and look at these things here. The nature of UX is about layered, about a lived experience, not just an experience in a laboratory. Okay? It's socially constructed, so it might be an individual, it might be a group of people together, because it's social. So these two columns, I think, are the more interesting part, which you should go back and have a quick scan through. Okay? So you can get that idea. Okay. So then we've got a set of five definitions using the zero. So let's have a little vote. You've all read these, right? You've got 1 minute to read these now, and then we'll have a little vote of what we think which ones we think are right. Many notes. It's not countdown. 30 seconds. So, who agrees with D1? Put your hands up. I will abstain from being around the chair. D1. 1, 2, 3. Yeah, quite a few. Okay, yeah.
Hold on, can you agree with more than one?
Let's make it exclusive. Let's make it exclusive.
Okay, I'm going to take that back.
Huh? Take your hand out?
Yeah,
so. Alright, okay. So, D2. Ooh! Let's have a look. Consequence of the user's internal state, the characteristics of the learning system, and the context within which the interactions occur. Nice. Okay, D3. D3, the intensity of effects that's elicited by the interaction between the user and the product. Okay, good. D4. Nobody. And D5. Quality of the air, good, quality of experience of interacting with specific design. So by that vote, you say something about yourselves. By what you think is, why you think this is the case, you say something about maybe your background, etc. Educational background, certainly. And indeed, it seems to me that that's exactly what's happened here as well. So, for instance, this one here, D1. Industry vote for it more than the rest. They vote for it more than academia. And the both. Okay? All those that are between both in industry and academia. Why do you think that might be?
Because the definition is looking at the vision of the entire company and then more company focused.
Yes, because it says in the definition company, yeah. Which therefore means that if you see that word company, if you see that word product, those are terms which bias as well what somebody's thinking. Okay, so when you write these, because you will do, you'll be writing questions, the language you use bias the people who are going to support it or not as well. So you need to be unbiased in that. Well, that's exactly what's happened. That's a little thing here. So this is why they've actually put this graph up. This is why they've done this work, because they know that they've biased it by their definitions. Yeah? They're not stupid. Okay, and we see D2, which is the one that all of you guys voted for. Not all of you, most of you guys voted for. Okay, D2, a consequence of the user's internal state. Well, academia likes this, and both like it. The between people like it more. They work for industry and both. But industry like it way less. Okay, and the reason why they like it way less is because it doesn't sound very operationalizable, I think. Yeah. It's not like you can... It's far more difficult to push it around products or companies. Right? Now, D3. Another one, entitled artifacts. Aesthetic experience of meaning, feelings and emotions. Okay, so, oh dear, industry didn't go to that one. Feelings and emotions, no, sell, buy. Okay, not that. But industry, but sorry, academia and the people who are both industry and academia quite like it. Yeah, that'd be good. Oops. D4. Now let's see. Product or service? I wonder who's going to vote for D4 just a little bit more. Well, certainly academia hates D4. You know, I think did nobody vote for D4? I don't think anybody voted for D4 here, so that means that you're pretty much like these guys, because not great. Some of the between people did, but mainly the industrial people liked it better. And the one at the bottom, quality of experience personalised when interacting with a specific design. This can range from specific artefacts such as a cup, toy, or website to a larger integrated experience such as a museum or an airport. Okay, why do you think industry like that more than academia doesn't mention product or company?
I think because it mentions a product or a company.
Yeah, it mentions a product or a company. That would be why I think it is, because these other ones don't. The ones that the academics like more kind of don't really. They're more about vision, they're more about intangibility, generalised concepts. They're not about things like toys or airports. So, yeah. Okay. We're running a bit behind, so I'm going to leave the timestamps for you to get to grips with. Okay? So, you can see when kind of user experience ought to be enacted. Yeah. And my view, this is my view, and I'm always right. But, you can look at my view and you can disagree with it as much as you want. Okay? And we can have a nice argument about it in the child. But, that's okay. So, why am I allowed to have this kind of view? Why are you allowed to have whatever view you like? Why don't any of us have to deal with view D1 to D5?
It's all subjective.
Well, it's kind of subjective, but also it's very new. It's a very new discipline. User experience is very new, and we don't really know how it's going to flesh out yet. So that's why we've got a number of people coming to speak with you about it. We've got the BBC, we've got Momenta, and hopefully in a couple of weeks we've got Thoughtworks. Okay, so all of this stuff is why you've got people coming to speak with you, because they've got different views of what user experience is, where the focus should be placed. And so that's the case with everybody. Okay, so as long as you're well-found, as long as you've got good rationale and it's well-found for you, that's also good. Okay. So my definition, which may evolve, and it's very like doing anything, it has evolved because I've deleted tested and added evaluated instead. Because I'm looking at user and better. That's my view, that's my definition of this whole user experience process. However, in your appendices, you'll find that there's, from All About UX, the All About UX website, in your appendices, you'll find there's about 27 competing definitions from all different kinds of people and all different kinds of companies, all different. So what you need to realise is, one, it's good to have your own view, but it's also good to recognise what other people's views are. And it might be that in a company, there isn't a shared view. The designers and the marketeers might have one view, and the developers might have a different view. Yeah. Or the developers and the designers might have the same view, marketeers might have another view, etc. Okay? So as long as you can understand where they're coming from. Right. Back at 4:15, please, and then we're going to poof it along, and we're going to tell you everything you need to know about users in all the first 5 minutes. Okay, you've got 10 minutes break, back and forth, please.
I'm going to go to the next one.
So what courses, HR courses, what courses?
I'm going to go to the next one.
And by it's elegant, you won't need to train the user to use it. as much. Okay. Now, before we get onto that, what are the kind of inputs as a human we've got to work with? Yes.
Our senses.
Our senses. And what kind of senses do we have? What kind of inputs do we have? Let's name you one.
Touch.
Okay, yeah, touch.
Auditory.
Or haptics, touch and haptics, yeah. Auditory, hearing.
Sight.
Sight, vision.
Taste.
Time.
If you're being on some fucking painkillers, you definitely need to pass your time, and you also have like sense of balance and everything else like that.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Balance, time, physical. Cognitive loss then for time.
Smell.
Smell?
Gut feeling.
Pardon?
Gut feeling? Sixth sense?
Visceral? Yeah. Okay. Okay. So what we've got all these different inputs to work with. But the main input, what's the main input that we're using?
Well, we're seeing what the...
It's mainly visual input that we're using. Now, one of the reasons why is because we're keen to use visual input. There's 58 areas of the brain distributed that allow us to do visual processing, okay, which is quite a lot more than a number of the other sensory areas. But it's not all, okay, and so we shouldn't think it is. So we should look at the way that we can design things. Now, of the brain, let's see if you need to move this. Okay, so how do we think, when you touch something, a signal gets to your brain? We know that if we're wiring something, you get electrons moving down a couple of strands or through the circuit board or something.
Yeah, it's similar sort of pulse, isn't it?
Pulse?
It's not a pulse, but it's an electronic in the neurosystem.
Yeah, and it's called an action potential. Okay, so we get an action potential, which comes up the axon, yeah, and it comes up through your spine, directly to your brain. So, what does? Okay, I'll use the colloquialism. What does snot do? What does mucus do? Nasal mucus do?
It blocks potentially harmful things in the air getting into our lungs.
No, not directly. Yeah? That's your follicles.
No. Which is to collect carbon bacteria that you might already have in your body.
No. Well, that's one point, but yeah. Okay, so what happens is that in your brain, your nerve system has little nerves dangling directly out of your nose, directly in your nose. So that the way you smell is a direct connection to your brain. Okay? There's a direct connection. And so your mucus is there to protect that direct connection. Okay? So that's why a lot of times when you smell something, it's not necessarily that it's filling your lungs, it's that it's got a direct connection to your brainstem. Yeah? So that's one of the reasons why we've got mucus. Which means that you thought kind of smell-based systems might also be useful, because that's a really powerful direct connection. So who's done anything on smell-based computing? No? I don't know, it's a trick. Stephen Brewster, University of Glasgow. So he had to work on smell-based computing. Okay? So this kind of stuff, this kind of thinking about the way that our brains work, the inputs that we can use might be useful, right? Might be. And that's what you ought to think about more. Now, most of the time, I admit, you're going to be doing stuff that is a standard computer system. Vision, you'll be typing in, using the mouse, that's it. Okay. But there are times when you might want to have more innovative ideas, and so not thinking about those ideas, and not thinking about the human in that system is really not a very much of a good thing to do. Yeah. Now, who knows anything about the brain? Say its orientation, its organisation.
In terms of left and right?
Okay, this is left and right, yeah. So, the olfactory bulb, the thing that we use to smell with, is it small or large compared to a cat?
Small.
It's a lot smaller than a cat. Or a rat, actually. So that suggests that they're going to use that part of their brain more. Yeah? Because it's bigger. You'd imagine. How much
how much do we know about neuro physiology? How much do we know kind of about neuroscience? Do we know everything there is to know about the brain, or do we not know very much?
Not so much.
Not so much. We don't know very much about it at all, really, comparatively speaking. Okay. But we do know how it's arranged and where those areas are. Now, I'm very bad at drawing, so you have to bear with me. Okay? So, that, and back, blah, 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 blah. Okay, something like this, with your bit of olfactory bulb sticking down the bottom. Yeah? Okay, that's my brain. Oh, that's great, isn't it? Yes. Okay, so, cerebrum and cerebellum. Which is which? Are there as many nerves in here, neurons in here, as there are in here? In this little bit at the bottom. Are there as many nerves in here as there are in there, neuron cells? There's more in here. Okay? There's more in here because this controls your motor reflexes a lot of the time. Okay, there is in your cerebrum motor areas. Okay, but here, this is what's controlling the way that your body's moving. Movement mainly. Okay? So we can see that because there's a lot in here, there's a lot to do. What's this thing coming in here?
Is it basically the hardwire to the spine?
Yeah, and it's called the brainstem. Okay, so the brainstem comes in here. Yeah? And so in the brainstem, you can destroy lots of parts of both of these. Yeah? But if you destroy any of the brainstem, you're likely to be dead immediately. Okay? That's how critical it is. The brainstem is looking at regulating things like temperature. Okay? Lots of autonomic functions. And then you've got little bits here along the Sylvian fissure and the central solstice. You have a thing here which is the auditory. Okay? Where do you think vision is?
At the front.
Vision is at the front?
The back
or the back. Okay, yeah. Okay, vision's at the back. Yeah? So we've got why do you think it's at the back?
It's close to the motor area rather than to the front of it.
No, the motor area is up the front. So in the middle, actually.
Part of the bottom.
Yeah. So, but part of this motor area, yeah. So, but this bit here, it's not because it's closer. It's one of the reasons they think, we don't really know, is that it's protected. You're far more likely to get a front impact than you are to get a rear impact, a back impact. Okay. So it's out of the way, which means that it's important. Okay. Hearing is up here in the middle, and then you've got your motor and your taste and your smell here. Okay? So this is the post-central gyrus and the pre-central gyrus, part of the central solstice there. Okay. All this is really important. All the other areas are associative memory areas, basically. Okay? So you can see that if you get a big smack to the front, you're going to have some memory issues. Okay. Now, why do I care about this? Well, because you're going to see some pictures of the brain. That's why. So it's useful for you to know what these areas are and how it all fits together. So, this is the what lobe is this bit called? The front. What kind of lobe is the front called?
Frontal.
Huh? Frontal. What's this top bit called? Parietal lobe.
Occipital
lobe. What about this bit?
Temporal.
Okay. Good. Now, we can see here that we've got your eyes. And what kind of vision do we have? It's called, begins with a B.
Binocular.
Binaural. Vision, yeah? Okay, but we can see that we've got this vision coming in, and we can see that it's moving to different sides of the brain. Okay, so it's opposite. Now,
What does this allow us to do? This kind of vision, these two eyes, what does it allow us to do? If you're using a pair of binoculars, and you're not using it, or you're using a monocular, what is the difference?
Depth.
Depth perception. So two eyes, you get way better depth perception than one eye. Yeah? Okay. And you can see this in far more detail, obviously, in Neuroscience at Glen Brain, if you want to read that, it's some background reading, it's a bit of a tomo of about 1,000 pages, basically, but it's kind of interesting. Okay, so this is a really useful thing to think about. So we know that vision, there's a lot of the brain devoted to vision, and the vision is well protected at the back, and we also know that it does a lot for us. Okay, so that's the first thing to consider. Right, perceiving sensory information, what about this? Well, we know where, in fact, it's marked there with a big A. So, the auditory cortex is here. And again, you get auditory distribution in the nerves that run up from the basal membrane, okay? And they go to a thing called the auditory olive. So the auditory olive is like a little olive shape, okay? And then it splits up each side of the brain. Okay, so it splits up each side of the input. Yeah? So therefore, going to the auditory cortex, you get stuff from both the left and right side going to both sides of the brain, but to a greater or lesser extent, because you've got a primary and secondary pathway. Now, that being the case, that means that we're processing different frequencies in the auditory cortex. Okay? So sometimes if you can't process some frequencies, you can process other frequencies in the auditory cortex. Okay? Because different aspects have different processing abilities. And this is called tonotopia. Okay? So you've got this kind of layout, if you like, that allows you to process different frequencies. Yeah? So why is this useful?
This is so you can sort of hear different things at the same time.
Yeah, you've got parallel inputs, but in this, and also, why might it be a problem knowing that this is actually split into different frequencies? Or if you know that, it, maybe it's not a problem. Because, yes?
Is it because if you're trying to give someone a realistic experience in terms of them hearing something, then you want to understand how it works in order to give them the best experience they can have?
That's true. That's very true. And also you want to be understanding with hearing the things called skull effect, where you've got vibration in the skull. But the main thing about the hearing itself, and certainly hearing the brain, is that different aspects of this brain, different aspects here, become less sensitive to the frequency over time. Okay? And so does the cell membrane. You don't get such good responses over time. So if you're using something that's a very high frequency, then if you're older, you're likely to not be able to hear that as well, or indeed at all. Yeah? So therefore, you've got to think, is your software going to give some high tone, high frequencies to older people? Because they're likely not to know. So when you've got a warning siren, get out of the building, we're all going to die. If you don't have some kind of, if it's only high frequency, some people won't be able to hear that. So they'll just sit there and yell. You can see this is the case as well with frequency stuff. There's some work that was done in Leeds, so Leeds University, some very interesting work on frequency. And having white noise in the mid-range of the frequency, having put white noise in the frequency allows you to better locate it in space. Okay. This action potential, how do you think it happens? This signal that's transmitted up in the body. Okay, so in general, you have a membrane, and on one side you have positive, normally on one side you have negative. Okay, and it's equally balanced, it's equilibrium. There's an equilibrium here. And what happens is, you have little, often, in most cases, pores through this membrane. And when you get some pressure on the outside, the positives go through, or the negatives go through, and you get an imbalance, and this negative-positive imbalance creates your action potential. And then it balances again, it equalises again once the pressure's taken off. Simple as that. Now, of course, this is just for the pressure,
You've also got lots to do with chemicals. So if you can have, obviously, chemical imbalances by, you know, if you put your hand in the silver fuel gas and as well as it's dissolving it off, you'll get a chemical imbalance there. Yeah? Okay. Taste. Taste and smell are all chemical. Yeah? Okay. Nasal cavity. So here we can see how we can actually perceive smell. Now we've got the nasal cavity at the top, we've got the palate, we've got the tongue, we've got the pharynx, and we've got the epiglottis. Yeah? And most of the stuff we're going to do is up here, up in the nasal cavity. Now, as I was saying before, we can see then that we can use touch, we can use sight, we can use hearing, to get the message through. What we're trying to do is get the message through to the user, right? That's what we're trying to do. And we can do the same with this sensory, okay, this smell. As I say, people have tried to use this before. What do we think to you? How does smell come across to you? Does it connect to you with... What we found, or what has been found, is that it's very good at bringing memories to the front. Okay, it's very good for retrieving long-term memory. So, if you associate a smell with something, a memory from a long time ago, and you smell it again, you're likely to remember the same thing. Yeah. It's very good at pulling out of long-term memory information. So, we don't use it at all. Very few people use it. There's only research systems that have been using it. But it's been proven to be very effective. Okay, it's allowing us to get information retrieval from our brain. Yeah? So it's another thing you ought to be thinking about, maybe. Original thought question for your exam. So why? If I said to you all, give me something with smell involved that could, you know, fit as part of a computer system. What might that be?
Yeah. The certain companies' websites, so like Cadbury's, give off their certain sort of aroma.
Once yeah.
You go onto their website to remind you of the produce, the chocolate, you know, that Cadbury's is. So.
Yeah, that's one might be one thing. Yeah.
Something like a perfume company can be able to taste the samples, much like iTunes usually tastes for their music.
Yeah.
So you can try their stuff and forth.
Yeah, taste samples, yeah. And more, yeah.
Set up like a reminder program to remind you of certain smells, like to mow the lawn, say fresh pepper rice.
Yeah, that's good, yeah.
The way there's some signs that cancel out other signs, do you think there's a way to generate smells that cancel out other smells? If you know what I mean.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I mean, very well maybe, it's beyond my chemistry.
Yeah.
You know, but that's quite a good idea, yeah. Any more?
Willy Wonka tries to make
Smell-o-vision, yeah. Smell-o-vision, Willy Wonka, yeah. Willy Wonka, yeah. Then one of that's original thoughts you thought about first. Yes?
Facebook photos could give you smells or foods or things that you've seen in them.
Yeah, Facebook photos could give you the list of smells or stuff in them. Do you think there's a benefit in having disjoint sensory experience such that you, for instance, you can either watch video, or you could have a picture or a slideshow with a soundtrack. There's a difference, because one isn't time sequence data with regard to the photo directly. But do you think there's benefit in that? And if there is a benefit in also adding the smell?
The video is more natural of what we actually see from our evolution, so we're more likely to take it.
That's right, the video is maybe more natural, but is it likely to be more memorable?
No.
It might be that...
I think we need less focus to a video than we do to a biophilic picture. I think we focus more on details of the picture.
Because it's not, yeah. That may be very true, yeah. I mean, also with regard to a soundtrack, even if that soundtrack is really what you would have recorded in real life on a video, you know, there's a lot of that. There's a lot of that that gives you this kind of slightly different experience, which jars so you remember it. Yeah. Yeah.
If you're giving somebody a slideshow, you're probably going to be telling them some kind of story or giving them a point of view over a number of points.
Yeah.
then if you've got some way of, if you've got a way of knowing what smells generally across a population associated with what kind of feeling, then you can tie that into each of these, and then, I don't know, subliminally, if this kind of smell comes across to the person who's viewing this presentation, they already know by association that they've been in a similar one.
Yeah, that's very true, yeah. Okay, so there's lots of ways I can see that you guys can think about how these kind of strange sensory inputs could be used. So I'm not saying that that's going to be the most efficient or the most effective, but I'm saying that you need to be open to it, just in case it is in the future. Okay. Attention. So, we're going to get on to, I'm going to leave this now. We've got another one on memory next. But, attention is something that you will obviously, will be getting back to, because we're going to be looking at eye tracking for Scott, okay? And how we section attention and where attention goes to. But because we're running a bit late, I'm going to skip this for today, okay? Okay, perceiving sensory information. So we've got declarative memory, and we've got non-declarative memory, okay? So here, we can see again that we've got these two sides of our, sort of, two sides of the coin. We've got the objective and subjective. We've got the things that are experiential and things that aren't. So we can see things like facts and events, we might have experienced, but that's not how we remember them, they're facts and events, in the declarative. And then we've got the emotional responses, say, in the non-declarative. Yeah. Now, memory is very interesting and very important to us, obviously, and learning as well, which we'll also be coming onto. Learning effects are a bit more difficult to quantify. With regard to memory, so what kind of things do you think, for your original thought question, up to this point, that we can, how could we kind of assist our memory? How could your computer systems assist your memory? Yeah.
Repetition.
So make things familiar so that you know where they are. Okay. That's one thing, yeah.
Association with more simple ideas.
Association with more simple ideas, yeah, absolutely.
Consistency.
So again?
Consistency.
Yeah, consistency. That's another way of doing it. The association with more simple ideas is also useful because you can have an association with more complex ideas, of course. You know, as long as you've got, most of the time, I would imagine when you're revising for your exams, you're revising keywords that allow your brain to remember what the hell that was all about. Yeah, and as soon as you've got that keyword, then you can remember what was, you know, everything else from it. Okay, that's often the way it works. And one of the ways that we can do, that we can perceive sensory information via exploration, but also one of the ways that we can remember stuff is via thinking about journeys, bizarrely, because we're very good at navigation, strangely. Okay? So one of the ways that we can think about think about memory and think about, say, your exam revision, is to think of various things on a road, on a journey. And once you've been trained to do this, it means that your memory becomes far more attuned to these kind of familiar components, yeah.
Isn't that a similar thing that, well, I've done before, where they put you, say, like, walking through your front door, and then they'll say an object and say, like, put that in your hallway, and then they'll say another object. They'll just list, like, eight objects,
yeah,
and straight to me, and then it's impossible to really, you'll get about four or five. But then they told me to put it into a room as you're walking around your house, picture, like, you can picture like a funny image of an elephant on your arbor or something, and then go around your house and you can somehow recognise it as well.
Yeah, it's that kind of procedural memory. Yeah, and that's this kind of procedural memory, this way that we're going through a process, it's a procedure which we're visualising as being a journey, is something that for most of us is far more logical, far more easy to do. Yeah. Okay, so that's other ways you can do things. Wow, I never realised there was a thing called Harper Road there. Okay, that's good. Alright, so we've got different kinds of communication here. What are these things here? What's this? It's the brain, for God's sake! Look, can you tell? It's the brain. Okay. And so what kind of scan is this?
It was an activity scan or...
Yeah, it's an activity scan. So it's
This one, I think it actually is an fMRI, but you can have a PET scan. It could be a, an event-related potential scan, too. Okay, so this is really, though, this is looking at where blood forms when people are hearing words, seeing words, speaking words, and thinking about words, and they are in different aspects of the brain, obviously. Okay? So here we can see that you can actually be hearing words while not really thinking about them much. Yeah? You can be seeing words, but you're not thinking about those words up here. You're just seeing them. Now, if you were seeing something, and we weren't thinking about it, what does that relate to from last week's lecture?
Attention blindness.
Attention blindness, yeah. So, last week we looked at a moonwalking gorilla while playing basketball. People's attention was on seeing what was happening, and also counting those things that were happening, but we weren't actually thinking about the scene itself. Because as soon as you defocus, there's a gorilla. It's a lot more complicated than this, of course, because you've got cognition, layers of cognition, perception, and behaviour overlay this. Okay. So these things that you need to think about with regard to communication and how you're communicating mean that you might want to use more than one different way of communicating the same thing. You might want vision and hearing to try and cement what's coming. We know very well that the older people get, the more they like both auditory and visual. Yeah? Okay. So therefore we like, well, visual I mean subtitles plus auditory track. Yeah? Okay. Skipping that. Okay, right, so input and output, this is general stuff, the kinds of input and output features you might have. So you've got keyboards. Primary input device, so this is the way you input everything in, obviously. We've got cursive, so we've got pen-based naturalistic input. Yeah? So that kind of thing is very, very easy on graphic tablets and that kind of stuff. That's one thing. Mice and trackballs, you all know. Speech-to-text recognition. Yeah? Anybody uses speech recognition? Yeah, a couple of people are doing it. It's quite good stuff, so that's what I'm getting in. False feedback. So you can actually, obviously, you've got some false feedback there in anything that you're using. You have false feedback back mice, false feedback joysticks, that kind of thing. Yeah. Touch. So you've got touch pads. Everybody's got a touch pad now, pretty much on their mobiles, except on their smartphones. Or you've got 3D gesture recognition, which you can also get on your Xbox. Now you've also got gestures on other things, like phones, etc. So you can have gesture, three-dimensional gestures on phones by waving in different patterns. Okay. And then we've got some specialist input. So, HOM. Anybody know what a HOM is? Head operated mouse. Okay, so you can use head operated mice if you're in a certain... if you're, say, physically disabled, or you don't have the use of your arms, you've got tremors, that kind of thing, so head operating mouse is useful. Blink. If you have a blink switch, because we can tell when you're blinking, because it takes far longer than a voluntary blink, takes far longer than an involuntary blink. Yeah? Eyes and gaze. Sorry, gaze and eye tracking, so we can actually control the screen by where we're looking. And immersive, so virtual reality. And then we've got suck blow. Okay? So these are pressure switches, where you've got Boolean input pressure switches for people who are profoundly physically disabled. Okay, mainly. Okay, any more? Have I missed any? Of the two sets, input general, control specialist, have we missed any? Yes?
Thinking left, thinking right.
Neural interface, that's a good one. Yeah.
Gesture recognition, so someone who's angry or happy or sad.
Okay, so that's a different thing. If they're unhappy, angry or sad, we're calling that emotional recognition now. Yeah, cool. Okay. Any more? Okay. Well, there are some more, but as long as you're thinking that there are lots of different ways of getting input in and getting information in and then getting that information out to the user, and that you NARC guys need to think that the user is a whole system. So just thinking to yourself, well, I'm only bothered about vision. I'm only bothered about vision and audio. That might not be the best way forward. Okay? So you need to kind of tailor your systems for what you think will be more effective. For instance, in flight simulation, or not flight simulation, even in flight, you've got obviously head-up displays, which make things a lot easier. However, you can also have lots and lots of force feedback controls. Okay? So those force feedback controls mean that when you're focusing on something which you've got a high cognitive overload, you've still got what's called a situational awareness of what's going on around you. Okay? Because we're getting input from other things like haptic. Okay, so for next week, pop quiz, I'll be picking on people. These are all the notes. What's the key focus of HCI? What's the purpose of the user experience specialist? What is user experience and how is it applied? If there are no 100% correct answers in UX, how do we decide what is right and what is wrong? What are the five key properties of user experience? Okay. Pick one, input modality, and describe it. And what's the four main sensory channels group experiment? Okay. So next week, pop quiz. Read your notes up to the end of It's Complicated. Building Under the Umbrella, we'll be looking at in a couple of weeks when Four Books comes. Okay, so you don't need to read Building Under the Umbrella. And I don't, so page 79 is just going to go back. Okay, you need to speak to me, come speak to me now, or see you next week.